2007. And during January 2020, the name changed to National Tuberculosis Elimination Program under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So we are providing, getting very good quality drugs, mostly tests including CBNAT. And most important, what I think is that a documentation and a follow-up of the patient, that is very, very important also. As we can see that 6 to 10% of pediatric patients are there, but many cases are underreported. And NTP also gave much importance to pediatric TB and also private and government partnership. I think these are two important points again at the organization level which happened. There are so many changes there in regarding treatment, in which everything is there, but as such a practitioner concerned, aren't this NTP give much importance to pediatric TB and also to private government partnership also. I would like to introduce my speakers, panel members. Next slide, Bala. Next. So we got three panel members. First of all, Dr. Ashraf, I think he need any introduction among IEP Kerala. He's additional professor of pediatrics. And he is also the president of IEP Calicut and state president of adults in Kerala. But what he's saying is his home social activities, and at the government official level, he had done a lot of work. Like he was a former executive director of Kerala Social Security Mission, former project director, state initiative on disabilities, and also former superintendent of IMCH. My second panel member is Dr. Balayanda. Again, he is well known to all of us. He is the senior consultant from Government Hospital Pathanamthitta, and he is dynamic, ever dynamic state secretary of IAP Kerala. He was also the organization secretary of the National Allergy State Conference of Kottayam, and there's so many other organizational activities also. And the third panel member is Dr. Manjusha. I think she's a budding pediatrician now emerging. I mean, after I think 5-6 years, we can see Manjusha in so many other platforms. Anyway, he completed his MBBS from Thrissur, and she's my student. And also completed a DCH and MD with the gold medal. And also she was the best outgoing student from Calicut. And also she got endowment award by best outgoing student also, and the PMC Nair gold medal award also. And he also participated and winner of many quiz program and paper presentation also. So with this few introduction about my panel members, I'll go to the topic proper. So my question, first question is to Dr. Ashraf. What is the magnitude of the TB problem in India and Kerala? Ashraf.
In India, 3.42 lakh children gets TB every year, which comes 31% of the global burden. Actually, the estimated cases is nearly double of that. Only 6% of cases reported to National Tuberculosis Elimination Program among children up to 14 years. Actually, the estimated percentage is 10 to 12%. That means only, next slide, Bala. Only 50 to 60% of cases are detected or reported to the system, to the RNDCP. The picture is not different in Kerala. In some of the districts, the percentage of children with the TB reported to RNDCP comes about 10%. Example, Malappuram, it is 15.7%. The total TB cases reported to RNDCP during the first quarter of 2020, that is January, February, March, is 497 cases in Malappuram, and 15.7% are cases under the 18 years of age. You can see that chart. The total cases reported to RNDCP in first 3 months in 2020 is 6,386 in Kerala. 8.5% is from pediatric age group. So even in Kerala, there are grows under detection or under reporting to the cases to the RNTCP. Over to you.
So there is a big gap, means under reporting below 5 years. So we have to concentrate below 5 years. Another important aspect is, Ashraf mentioned, is that extra pulmonary tuberculosis is more common when compared to adult. So my next question to Dr. Bala. So what is the difference between pediatric and adult tuberculosis? Basic difference. Dr. Bala.
Thank you, Andreshan sir. So as Ashraf sir said, there is a huge gap is there in reporting, and maybe that is the reason for Kerala showing an annual drop in 7.5% in the pediatric tuberculosis, even though in the under 5 mortality, the leading causes being pneumonia, diarrhea, and infection such as, but the 10% of the causes come under others, of which tuberculosis is the most important. It's, of course, there will be some overlap between pneumonia death and tuberculosis death, and anyway, tuberculosis death will come under the 10%. And the TB diagnosis in children continues to be a challenge due to many reasons. One of the reasons is the Posibacillary disease, where we get a lot of negativity, CB9 or sputum smear in children. The positivity rate is very less because of the Posibacillary disease, and there is difficulty in getting appropriate samples. To expectorate is difficult for children. And as sir has said, the EP, the extra pulmonary tuberculosis, is more in children than in adults. Even though pulmonary TB is the most common in both children and adults, extra pulmonary tuberculosis is more common in children. So these are the three differences between one of the three differences between pediatric TB and adult TB. And pediatric cases, they have, children are higher chance of infection and vulnerability. Even though the male-female ratio is one, in adults it is more than 75% is more common in males. And this has been, Ashraf sir has said, so there's a huge detection gap in children, even in at the below the age of 5 years, there is a detection gap of 69%, and in the age group of 5 to 14 years, there is a detection gap of 40%. Overall, there's a 55% detection gap. And also, so where do we miss children with TB, and we are creating a gap? This is because of the clinical versus microbiological diagnosis in tuberculosis in children. As you can see from the chart, that even the out of 1,479 pediatric cases, only 384 are microbiologically confirmed. And in adults, whereas it is just vice versa, it is 4,340, 10,278 out of 15,000 as microbiologically confirmed. Maybe that is one reason for creating this gap. The fourth difference between children and adults is the presentation. In children, the most even the common symptoms are we can see symptoms like tuberculous conjunctivitis, tuberculous lymph node, dactylitis, gibbous deformity. All these are more common in children. And other presentations, Ashraf sir will tell in the next slide. And the fifth difference is the type of infection the children are getting. As you all know, one child is come in contact with a source case, 70% chance there will be no infection and there won't be any disease. But 30% children will get infection, and depending on the microbial virulence and host immunity, this will 90 if the microbial bacterial virulence is more, the child will get primary disease, whereas if the host immunity is more and microbial virulence is less, it will be 90 to 95% will go into persistent latent infection. That there lies the importance of LTBI. So the risk of developing disease, overall risk is 5 to 10%, but in infancy, if an infant is exposed to a positive case, 50%, more than 50% chance of getting primary disease, and in 1 to 5 years age group, 25%. There also lies the importance of chemoprophylaxis. The sixth difference is the dosage of drug dosage in is higher than in adults, and seventh is that TB preventive therapy, that is up to 18 years, we give prophylaxis in with the history of contact with any form of active tuberculosis. And the X-ray, the radiology part, and the physicians will be dealing with extensively. But here, three important differences that is suggestive when you go into that algorithm. We go for CVNAT only if the TBA X-ray is suggestive. Suggestive means when there is lymph node, when there is miliary, or when there is fibro cavity lesions. Otherwise, we won't say it is suggestive, and depending on that, we go for CVNAT. But in adults, it is not like that. Any change in the chest X-ray, we go for investigation. And the next difference is the smear positivity. When we have 6% and 8% in primary and progressive primary positivity in children, in the adults, it is almost 50-50, 50% chance of getting positivity. And the last is the ESR role. And we all know high ESR, more than 100 we see in autoimmune condition, malignancy, and previously it was called tuberculosis, but now it has changed in pediatric TB. ESR has no role in the diagnosis. And there, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Bala, for elaborating the difference between adult and pediatric tuberculosis. As you mentioned, the incidence of tuberculosis below, getting tuberculosis below 5 years, around 50%, and in infants, maybe up to 25%, and also a lot of difference, either by clinical manifestation or radiological, or your smear positivity also different in adult and pediatric age group. Thank you. Our next question is to Manjusha. Why we have to concentrate on children below 5 years? Manjusha? Manjusha is not there in the screen. Bala.
Manjusha. Manjusha is not there.
Manjusha is not there. We can, I see she's there, but.
She must have muted.
Manjusha, please.
Manjusha is not there. She must have. I will. Or we will answer. Hello. Andeshan sir.
അതായത് മഞ്ജുഷ അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്തിട്ടില്ല അതാണ് എനിക്ക് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്നുണ്ടായിരുന്നില്ല മഞ്ജുഷനോട് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ രഞ്ജിത്ത് മഞ്ജുഷ ഈസ് ഓൾസോ ഇൻ മ്യൂട്ട്
ഓ മൈ രണ്ട്
നിഹാസ്
ഓക്കേ ഓക്കേ നിഹാസ് രഞ്ജിത്ത് രഞ്ജിത്ത്
മഞ്ജുഷ മീറ്റിംഗിൽ ഔട്ട് ആണ് സർ
ആരാ ഔട്ട്
മഞ്ജുഷ മീറ്റിംഗിൽ ഇല്ല
അല്ല ഔട്ട് അല്ല മ്യൂട്ട് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്നില്ല അത് ആ സെക്യൂരിറ്റി ഇതിനകത്ത് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് സെൽസ് ആക്കണം അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഞാൻ ഷോപ്പ് ഷെയർ ചെയ്തിട്ട് ചെയ്യാം
മഞ്ജുഷനെ കാണുന്നുണ്ടല്ലോ നിഹാസെ
അല്ല അത് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ നിഹാസ് ചെയ്യണം പോസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യണം
നിഹാസ് ഒന്ന് പോസ്റ്റ് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യണം
ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട് സാറേ
ഞാനും ഇതുവരെ മ്യൂട്ട് ആയിരുന്നു ഇപ്പൊ എനിക്ക് പറ്റിയത് അതായത് പോസ്റ്റ് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നില്ല എന്ന് പറയുന്നുണ്ടായിരുന്നു
അൺമ്യൂട്ട്
ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട് അൺമ്യൂട്ട്
ആയിട്ടുണ്ട് ഏതായാലും ഈ സ്ലൈഡ് ബാല പറ
അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ആയിട്ടുണ്ട് സാർ
First of all, thank you IAP Kerala, Andhakeshwan sir, Bala sir, and Ashraf sir for this platform. So my question was, why is the TB in less than 5 years so important? As was already mentioned in the previous slides by our eminent speakers, we have seen that TB-related deaths may have gone unnoticed as pneumonias and not accounted for in under 5 mortality. So still TB deaths may be a big chunk of our under 5 mortality. And there are no standard definitions, nor there are standard tests to diagnose. And it's very difficult to get a specimen from an under 5-year-old child. So these are the reasons why it is going underdiagnosed, as well as even if you diagnose, it's underreported. So lack of data is one problem that you find in under 5 children. So the next slide, please. These graphs have already been dealt with. The gap in the detection and reporting of children less than 5 years is a big problem. And strategies on improving the under 5 mortality focuses on many other fields, and less emphasis is given to TB diagnosis and treatment here. And of course, as was clearly mentioned in the slide before, there are a lot of differences between the presentation, the diagnosis, and the confirmation of tuberculosis in adults and children. And there is a higher risk of progression to infection and then remaining as a latent TB or then getting cured of TB by their self-immunity in under 5 children. And younger children are more vulnerable to have disseminated diseases. Hence, it is very imperative to catch them very early and treat them and diagnose and treat them very early. And as I told, children can be infectious as well. It's not that a small child is not infectious. Even children with TB can be infectious and a source of infection to the community.
And there is a sir out aaya.
So at the same time, children are more vulnerable for the tuberculosis. Same time, there is a problem of underreporting. So it is a duty of every pediatrician in Kerala or India to report all cases of tuberculosis promptly through government agencies. Okay, thank you, Dr. Manjusha. Next one to Dr. Afra. When to suspect a tuberculosis and what are the guidelines according to NTAP?
All the symptoms of tuberculosis are non-specific. The three cardinal symptoms are fever, unremitting cough, and no weight gain or loss of more than 5% of the body weight in past 3 months. Fever may be a manifestation of pulmonary as well as the extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Cough may be a manifestation of pulmonary tuberculosis and weight gain, pulmonary as well as the extrapulmonary. For the extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the other symptoms are peripheral painless swelling, lymph node enlargement, or an insidious onset of meningitis, or a spinous gibbous, or any non-specific symptom in a contact of an infectious TB case. Infectious TB case means pulmonary TB case. Any child in contact with a pulmonary tuberculosis, any non-specific symptom, we should search for tuberculosis. Next slide. Fever, that means persistent more than 2 weeks. Unexplained fever of more than 38 degrees Celsius reported by guardian or objectively recorded at least one time. The persistent cough means, we all know there are a lot of reasons for cough. It may be a viral infection, it may be an asthmatic or atopic disease or tuberculosis. I will come to that next slide. Then weight loss, it is a non-specific symptom. The cough, there are three patterns. One is that green line, acute with delayed recovery. That is suggestive, very much suggestive of a viral cough. Then intermittent pattern, that is usually in the asthma or wheeze-associated respiratory infection, which is very common among our children. In tuberculosis, that red line, it is a persistent and unremittent cough. That is the difference between the cough in tuberculosis, in VZ children, and in viral infection. Next slide. Next slide. So the previous slide. History of contact is very important. Next slide. Yeah. History of contact is very important. That means in a symptomatic child, any history of contact with any type of tuberculosis is important. The reason is there may be an asymptomatic pulmonary involvement in extrapulmonary TB also. In other words, in any child with a contact with a pulmonary tuberculosis needs evaluation to rule out tuberculosis. Suppose father is having tuberculosis, if there is a child of age of 4 years, we have to rule out tuberculosis in that without any symptom. But in an asymptomatic child, even non-pulmonary contact is important. I think you got the point. If the contact is pulmonary, all the asymptomatic children needs evaluation to rule out TB. But in a symptomatic child, the pulmonary contact is important as well as non-pulmonary contact is also important. Any contact within 2 years. Okay. out of moderator.
Thank you, Dr. Ashraf. So the three main companies, Fever, Cough, and weight loss. It is very common because due to several reasons, we may get fever and also cough. As Ashraf rightly mentioned, either asthmatic cough or viral infection due to cough, we may get cough also. And the last one is every school going children, the mother, main complaints of the parents or mother is that they're not taking food, weight loss. So we have to take a proper history. Means fever should be recorded, cough should be non-remittent cough, and the weight loss should be documented. So thank you, Ashraf. Now, my next question to Dr. Balendra, what are the risk factors for pediatric TB?
So factors for TB infection and disease, we can do it separately. For a child to get infected, the risk factors are mainly increased exposure depending on the source and contact with the source case. So in the increased exposure, the living in endemic areas, living with families living with HIV and overcrowding, tobacco smoke and pollution. So these will come under the exposure. And if a case with a cavitated lesion, positive case with cavitated lesion, chance for the children getting infected is more. And if the cough frequency is more and if the patient is not doing the cough hygiene, then also the chance for infection is more. And also if an adult or a positive case delays his treatment, his or her treatment, then also even one day is important, that chance for getting infection is more. And the closeness of contact is very important. The contact history, contact definition, that close contact, household contact, Dr. Manjusha will deal. And the duration of contact is also important. Even 8 hours of close contact itself can get, a child can get an infection. For a child to get TB disease, there are 5 risk factors. One is depending on the age. For a child less than 2 years, risk is more. For children with HIV infection, chance for getting is more. Children with malnutrition and post-measles time, the chance for getting is more. And those who are not vaccinated, there lies the importance of BCG vaccination. Even though the BCG efficacy in pulmonary tuberculosis is only 0 to 80%, if a child is properly vaccinated with the BCG, the risk of disseminated disease like Miliary tuberculosis and risk of tuberculosis meningitis is very less. And the importance of chemoprophylaxis also comes here. A child with the history of contact, if not given chemoprophylaxis, that child can go in for tuberculosis disease. This chart will show the importance of that age. The up to 5 years, children are exposed to tuberculosis meningitis, chance for more getting tuberculosis meningitis, Miliary tuberculosis, and lymphoma tuberculosis. Whereas the school age period is there relatively safe, and the adolescent children are more chance for getting pleural effusion and adult type of tuberculosis. So these are the risk factors for getting children getting infection and disease. Sir, Anderson, sir. Anderson, sir.
That is muted.
They rightly mentioned the source of contact, type of contact, age of the child, and of course, malnutrition, measles, everything will account for the severity of the tuberculosis. And of course, in all cases, we have to do HIV testing also. All tuberculosis cases, you have to rule out HIV. All HIV cases, you have to rule out tuberculosis also. So to my next question to Dr. Manjusha, who is a contact? I think partly explained by Dr. Ashraf. So who is a contact?
So a contact of a symptomatic child is any person with any form of active tuberculosis. So my stress is on the word any form. Within the last 2 years, that is a patient who is symptomatic may have come in contact with a pulmonary TB or an extra pulmonary TB. Both these cases are taken as contacts of this child, because especially in pulmonary TB, because it is an active focus where they can be bacilli. In extra pulmonary TB, they might be an unrecognized coexisting pulmonary involvement where bacilli may be there, may not be actually got or procured in your diagnostics, but still they might be bacilli in the pulmonary. So this can be a source of infection for the child. So it is very important in a symptomatic child who has features fitting into a symptomatic TB child. And so such a child having these contacts, both pulmonary and extra pulmonary, within the last 2 years should be taken as a contact.
So this one is thing different from the previous one, I think, because previously it was thought that it is only open definition saying that it is only open case of tuberculosis, a pulmonary case of tuberculosis. Now it is any case of even though it is a bone tuberculosis or any other type of tuberculosis, it is included as a case of contact. So what are the main radiological features? Bala? So, X-rays in tuberculosis is a very important mode of investigation because the primary childhood TB being positive partially already mentioned. So microbial diagnosis is very difficult. But there are so many problems with the personal variation, reading the X-ray. There will be variation. Some of them will cancer, there will be hilar lymph node, some of them will be, there will be anything. Only to a film and technical error, again very problem. And also so many artifacts. So errors in radiograph interpretation can lead to both under and over diagnosis. So proper positioning of X-ray is very important. And also the personal bias means there are so many variations also there, because you can see the over diagnosis of the by X-ray alone. Actual cases around 40%, whereas the out of 100 cases only 40% go to actual. And that means you are over diagnosing tuberculosis by X-ray. In olden days it is a routine, but patient with the fever, cough, and weight loss will take an X-ray and be forced to start a kit. Next one. So always the quality of X-ray very, very important, because it should be properly exposed, the penetration should be ideal, the position should be ideal, there should not be any rotation. Here you can see underexposed film. Here we cannot see properly the hilar adenitis, or you cannot make out any pneumonic patches, you cannot make it. Next one. Here you can see grossly, it may appear that the paratracheal lymph node here appears, but here you can see the position of the clavicle, it is totally rotated film. Next one. So you can see it is thymus only in a proper position. You can see now the position of the clavicle and the position, you can see it is clavicle only. So the proper position, penetration. Next one. Next one, Bala. So when you are seeing a chest X-ray, previous one. So when you're seeing an X-ray, first of all, you have to think that whether it is normal or abnormal. And if it's abnormal, whether it is suggestive of TB or not TB. Here you can see X-ray with it is abnormal X-ray. Then we have to confirm whether it is TB or not TB. Here you can see that the middle and the lower lobe is collapsed. So but it is, the film is not underexposed. So next film. Next one. So he can see the properly exposed. Previous one. So he can see here, you can see the properly exposed. So a metallic foreign body was not visible previously. Now it is visible. So we may overdone to book. So what I want to say that the proper positioning of the X-ray, rotation should not be there, and the ideal and also the expiration or inspiration, proper inspiratory position, all things are very important. Next one. So here you can both X-ray, you can compare, both are abnormal. So first one, whether it is TB not, because you can see it may be a collapsis as we already seen, most probably it may be a tuberculosis. But in second one, you can see, as we already seen, in a proper position, you can see there's a metallic foreign body on right side of the branches of wrong, you can see the foreign body there. So proper position is very important, as well as also very important. Next one. So first you have to consider, in any case already mentioned by Ashraf, more than 2 weeks fever and a cough and a weight loss and X-ray, whether you are to consider it is normal or abnormal. If it is abnormal, then it suggests you have tuberculosis or not. Next one. So three important features of pediatric X-ray, as Bala mentioned, one is lymph node enlargement, second is miliary tuberculosis, third one is fibrocavitary. These are the three important findings in X-ray, and also in addition to this one, we'll get some other findings also. Next one. So it may be a pattern like a consolidation, especially a child with pneumonia, not responding to right dose of antibiotic, right dose, right duration, and also proper intake of the antibiotic, then you can consider it may be tuberculosis, and no homogeneous opacity, round glassing, and thin walled cavity, or maybe non-specific, but with the background of a history and other examination and laboratory support, you have to support X-ray with the X-ray. Next one. Next one. So lymphadenopathy is one important picture, what we used to say lymphadenopathy. So lymphadenopathy may be either hilar lymph node, previous one, hilar lymph node, or it may be paratracheal, or it may be subchondral. Subchondral lymph node we can make out by the measuring the angle between two branches of trachea. It's not easily possible, and so all this is a dilated signs. So many times the tracheal, the lymph node shard may be over-diagnosed by SF. So sharply demarcated and lobulated density. Now, there are so many indirect signs also, means a contour of calibre of trachea, any features of the compression of trachea, then collapse, secondary collapse, everything you have to consider. So not only the lymph node alone, but there are indirect signs also you have to take in consideration. Next one. So you can see that here, previous one, one by one, Bala. So here you can see, right side you can see here, there is a gross collapse of the right side of the trachea due to lymph node compression. And left side also there is infiltration is there, but due to compression of the lymph node, as you graphics also seen the same, you can see the dome of the diaphragm is elevated. Next one. And the main, the radiological features is typically gone focus. You will get a drainage lymph node and the area, surrounding area. That is gone focus shown here. And also, the first figure, you can see the hilar lymph node, you can see that. And the second figure, you can see there is some pneumonic patch. But it can happen in bacterial pneumonia also. But you can see on the left side, in second picture, on the left side, you can see one lymph node. So that may be again a feature of maybe due to tuberculosis only. So you can see left side, you can see that is lymph node enlargement also, you can see the same figure. So what is the fate of gone focus? So a primary infection, a gone focus may progress and it may lead to progressive primary tuberculosis, or it may be contained by itself, a natural heal, or it may be by treatment also, and later it may be reactivated also. Next one. And according to the site of the compression, regional lymph node compression, it may lead to bronchopneumonia consolidation, atelectasis, partial or complete obstruction, or it may affect the parenchymal cavitation with the intrabronchial spread, leading to progressive pulmonary tuberculosis. And again, it may lead to spread to contagious area like pericardium, pleura, or maybe lead to hematogenous spread leading to miliary TB. These are the usual fate of gone focus. So all these complications you have to consider when you are seeing a tuberculosis patient, advanced case of tuberculosis. Next one. So here you can see that, which I mentioned. So you can see hilar lymph node. Again, you can see the right paratracheal lymph node. So it may be a primary tuberculosis. Next one. And you can see sometimes you may get a bronchopneumonia-like picture. So both side you can see lymph node compressing, leading to partial obstruction, collapse, and again leading to pneumonic patch, bilateral pneumonic patch in second X-ray. You can see that one. Next one. And very clear. You can see there are so many other conditions also. You are thinking because you may get so many other conditions. Sarcoidosis, lymphoma, leukemia, other pneumonia also you may get hilar lymph node. But most common, based on history and other clinical examination, and treatable condition in our setup, we have to think about because sarcoidosis is all this very uncommon. Leukemia and lymphoma are not very common. So, higher and the medicine lymphoma give very important proof. Next one. And again, the pneumonia. So here you can see the pneumonia. What will give clue? So you have to give antibiotics. Antibiotics, when I think our next speaker will describe this one. You have to give antibiotic with not active against tuberculosis. You have to exclude quinolone group. You have to exclude insulin. So all these antibiotics should not be given. So one clue is that if pneumonia is not responding to conventional right dose of antibiotic, you have to think about again think about tuberculosis. So here you can see one of our child, 12-year-old child, 2 weeks of fever and 7 days cough, breathlessness of 2 days. Next one. You can see a patch in the right upper lobe region. You can see, just see the size of the patch here. So we thought, because she's a 12-year-old girl, no other predisposition, no family history of tuberculosis. We can just watch this, the size of the pneumonia shadow here. Then we are given antibiotic. Next one. So the shadow is increasing. So child is not responding to antibiotic, so the shadow is increasing. And you can see the right, left side, you can see a lymph node also. Next one. And her FB was positive. Very rarely we used to get a positive smear in children. So here FB was positive and HIV was negative. Next one. And we are putting her now. You can see now the size of the pneumonic shadow is decreased. So pneumonia not responding to the right dose of antibiotic also you have to think about a case of tuberculosis. Yes, again, fluid efficient, very common. I'm not going to detail because whether transudate, exudate, everything you have to consider. In our time, when we are studying MBBS, all fluid efficient, maybe due to tuberculosis until otherwise proved. But nowadays, we are getting so many cases of bacterial effusion also. Yes, again, another case of a pleural effusion. Next one. So, pleural effusion in the classic signs include uniform homogeneous opacity, postoperative ganglia is obliterated, and you can see the mediastinal shift also. And yes, you can see the early signs also. These are the classical features of pleural effusion. Next one. And also, even though it is not very common in our setup, but in North India and other area, late presentation, we can see fibrocavity pneumonia on both sides. In second figure, also, you can see multiple cavities. In our setup, we have to think about staphylococcus pneumonia also, such a condition. It's not very common here in our area. Next one. So, he can see that recurrent cough and loss of weight, you can see large shadow. Since this is included in a tuberculosis discussion, you may think it is you can say that now it is tuberculosis. But we cannot give it because some mass like lesion. And some bulging, something like that. Next one. So here you can see that lateral X-ray give the just middle lobe effusion, not respond to AKT. So that is, I want to stress here the importance of the lateral X-ray. That is, I showed this X-ray. So in APA view, it is something different. So APA, it is middle lobe effusion only. So you can see the LOBs of hidden area, retrocardiac, some other area, you can see that. Next one. Again, a lateral chest X-ray, you can see here, clear cut definite sign. Next one. Next one. So here important is that the lateral X is very important. Definite means the upper part, means in Malayalam, raw part, horse show part, the upper part and the side part is worn by right pulmonary artery and the left pulmonary artery. The lower part is completed by high lateral. So you'll get a definite sign. That is very important lateral X-ray. Next one. And the miliary tube, of course, you can see it may mimic so many conditions also, but the classical miliary tuberculosis. Next one. So you may get a miliary shadow, many conditions you get. So you may get a miliary tuberculosis, bronchopneumonia, pulmonary edema, pulmonary infarction, interstitial lung disease, nowadays coming up. Tropical eosinophilia, aspiration pneumonia, but in our setup, miliary shadow is very, very common due to tuberculosis only, but you have to rule out other conditions also once in a while. Next one. Here you can see a child with recurrent cough and a crepitation on left lower lobe, and it is 111. Next one. So even after 1 month, this shadow is persisting. The same shadow persisting. You can see some lower lobe collapse on left side. So we got we got a coarse crepitation. Next one. Next one. So you can see that bronchitic changes here. So that is important. So bronchitis, fibrocavitation, even though it is not very uncommon, but once in a while you are think about it. So reading red. Next one. Okay, summary. So to sum up, so reading radiography is important skill, and TB suggestive and not suggestive shadow on the chest X-ray. Whether it is a normal, abnormal. If it's abnormal, whether it is a TB shadow or non-TB shadow. And always think about the technical error, proper exposure, rotation, expiratory view, and also adenitis, miliary tuberculosis, and fibrocavitation are considered to be TB suggestive. And many times it may overlook or underlook. So you should be always think about tuberculosis if you are getting a shadow of adenitis or miliary shadow or fibrocavitation. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Hey, Renesa.
So another important aspect for pediatrician, especially we are for years and years, we are using tuberculin test. There are some changes in the newer guideline. So to talk about this one, we got our Ashraf. Ashraf, what about tuberculin test? Is it with, so how will you, means what is important changes in newer guidelines?
Yes, Dr. Ananda Keshavan mentioned, previously we are doing Mando test and we are encircling the Mando before writing tuberculosis prescription. Now the scenario has changed. The X-ray gained popularity in the diagnostic algorithm, whereas Mando test lost its popularity in diagnostic algorithm according to the newer guidelines. In 2014 guidelines, whenever you suspected tuberculosis in a child, the first investigation was CBNAT. But in 2019, it has changed to X-ray and Mando. Now it is X-ray. X-ray is the frontline investigation. A positive Mando means there is a hypersensitivity reaction to delayed hypersensitivity to tuberculosis antigen. That means there is a TB infection, which may be a recent infection, which may be a past infection. Negative does not rule out the infection also. So positive Mando doesn't mean a TB disease. Mando may be positive or a negative in TB disease. Mando may be positive in a microbacteriologically confirmed tuberculosis, or it may be negative in a clinically diagnosed TB also. Role is very, very limited in 2020 recommendation, except in the clinically diagnosed probable TB. I will come to that. Compared to the, this is the algorithm 2019, where you can see Mando along with the chest X-ray. Next slide. Next slide. This is the algorithm 2020, where you will not see the Mando. But there is a green area, no other likely alternative diagnosis. Treat as a clinically diagnosed probable TB case. There is a greenish area. That is clinically diagnosed TB. That means if the child is having symptom suggestive, X-ray suggestive, but CBNAT is negative, then you rule out all other possibilities to rule out a persistent pneumonia or a recurrent pneumonia. Then if there is a Mando test for the suggestive symptom, suggestive radiology, the Mando positivity is a supportive evidence like that of a contact history. But for the diagnosis of latent tuberculosis, especially in a nephrotic syndrome child, if you are, for an example, if you are going to treat, start steroid, you have to do a Mando test. If it is positive, you should put that child on prophylaxis. So Mando has a definite role in the prophylaxis or latent TB detection, but it has lost its popularity as a diagnostic tool, except in a clinically diagnosed probable TB. That means the child is having suggestive symptom plus suggestive radiology or a doubtful radiology. Okay.
I think it's a very clear cut answer by Dr. Ashraf. There's no doubt like that. It's latent TB. You can use it. And whenever there's a doubt, as in case rightly mentioned with the clinical features, radiological shadow, but unlikely you are not getting a CBD at night, something like that, then you can empirical, you can diagnose tuberculosis and you can start it. But it is very, 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 very think before starting based on Mando alone. But some importance it is lost, that's true. Next one is that also Mando test, now it is some doubtful X-ray, okay, now got more importance. Then what about ESR? So to Bala, what is about ESR?
So, as I said earlier, ESR was previously in the algorithm of diagnosis of tuberculosis. We used to say when the ESR is more than 100, we should think of autoimmune disease, malignancy, tuberculosis, or pneumonia. But now it is from the last year, from 2019, because of the too many pretest variables like anemia, fasting, method, coagulant, which all affects the ESR determination. Anemia in fasting, and also in the type of method used for determining the ESR, the coagulant used, all these will affect the ESR. So ESR has no role in diagnosis and has no specificity also.
So the message is clear here. Whenever there is a recurrent infection, some other infection, and you may get so many technical error also, anemia also, you'll get the highest because majority of population are with anemia. So the previous symptom like that, with the Mando positive, ESR high, and with some clinical features, some shadow here and there in X-ray, you cannot start tuberculosis and tuberculosis treatment. So it is very clear. So ESR lost its value now. And my next question is to Manjusha. What is IGRA? And there's some problem with Mando. So what is the role in TB diagnosis? Is it better than Mando? And what other serologic tests you can advise? Manjusha?
Yeah. Now, coming from the more common, less costly tuberculin skin test and the ESR, we are coming to a much newer and a more costlier investigation, which is IGRA, or the interferon gamma release assay. So it's just a process where you are stimulating your T cells and a monocytes with the TB antigens and then eliciting a response, which is measured in the terms of the quantity of interferon gamma, which is produced. The two commercially available kits are the ESAT-6, which is the early secreting antigen tubercular bacilli 6, and the culture filtrate protein 10 and the TB 7.7. And the Quantiferon Gold, the past few years, Quantiferon Gold had a lot of advertisement. Most of the labs are doing it. And another commercially available kit is the ELISpot TB. Both these uses these antigens, which the Quantiferon can detect it as a whole, all the three antigens at one go, and the ELISpot for different antigens. And there is always a negative control and a positive control, a positive control in the form of a mitogen and a negative control in the form of unstimulated T cell. And this just shows us that there is an immune response that the body has mounted against the tuberculosis antigen. And again, as with the Mando test, this is only useful in latent TB because this detects the immune response which the patient already had mounted when he had a previous infection, or it can be the immune response that he is producing now to a recent infection. So it cannot differentiate between. So can we go to the next slide, please? So here we have the advantages and disadvantages of IGRA. Advantages, one, it is highly specific and sensitive, and it can detect any form of TB infection we know not 100%, but it still has a high sensitivity to detect TB infection. Mind you, it is TB infection and not TB disease. Second, it is not affected by BCG. BCG affecting our Manto test is a huge concern, especially in infants where BCG, a false positive Manto by a recent BCG can be there. So this is one test that bypasses the BCG effect, and this is not affected by BCG. And as with and unlike the Manto test, it does not boost responses. We are very concerned because sometimes we see children getting Manto every fortnight or every month. And we are concerned that the positive Manto is because of the previous boosting, the boosting response of the previous doses. But this does not happen with IGRA. And again, you don't have to call back the child to assess the reading as with the Manto test. You need only a single OPD visit, and results are available in 24 hours. All these seem very good for a test that can detect TB. But on the other side, we have, I think, more disadvantages. One, the first disadvantage is you cannot predict disease. You can only predict infection. And that does not help, because you don't know if this child had latent TB and was treated last year, or if the child had TB infection last year and was treated, his IGRA would be still positive. You do not know if it is that immune response or if it's a reinfection. Again, it's blood that has to be collected. It has to be transported and within 8 to 30 hours, and it has to be transported in a strict conditions. So all these affects, as with any lab test, the transportation, collection, the processing, everything affects the result of IGRA. And there are not much studies to show the effect or the efficacy of IGRA in less than 5 years of age in people who are not able to mount an immune response, like people with immunodeficiency on immunosuppressive drugs. And of course, it's very expensive. Again, it falls back in the diagnosis of TB in children and only has a role in diagnosis of latent TB infection. And so next slide. Serological test is a big no. Government of India has banned all serological tests for TB because it has very poor sensitivity and specificity, and has also come forth with a gazette banning all serological tests in India. Yes, sir. I'm done, sir. So this is a gazette that came out in June 2012.
Andeshan, sir?
I think, Anandakeshan, you mute yourself. Anandakeshava? Bala, I will answer that question.
Okay.
And,
okay.
Hello, am I audible?
Now you are audible.
So yes, Manjusha rightly mentioned, even though there are so many advantages of the IGRA test, like BCG won't affect it, and you can get the report the same day, but it is expensive. So many other technical errors, they are not widely available. I think for time being, we are not recommending TB test, IGRA test. Second one is that I think serology test nowadays not doing, it is banned also. There's no question of it. IgM, TB, IgG, all things are banned. Nowadays, I think it's not available in any lab also. So, so the NTP guidelines is the clinical detection of the microbiological detection of the AFP. Main thing is the children, it is foci bacilli. We want to get a fibrocavitary lesion. So the yield is very poor. So very, very important one is that is proper sputum collection. So that how can we improve the percentage of yield of the AFP from a sputum sample? Over to Ashraf.
Because of the drug-resistant tuberculosis is a public health problem. The microbiological confirmation is important in pediatric TB also. Now it is more easier because we are having rapid diagnostic test, CBNAT. So RNTCP recommends universal drug sensitivity testing, because if the child is a contact of a drug-resistant TB, he may have drug-resistant TB. So diagnosing drug-resistant TB is important, because if you are treating a drug-resistant TB with a conventional regime, that will increase the morbidity, that will spread the infection in the community. That is the importance of the drug sensitivity testing in the current scenario. Next slide, please. So, for the bacteriological confirmation, there are three barriers. One is children does not expectorate sputum. The solutions are gastric aspirate and induced sputum. Pediatric TB is, of course, it is posibacillary. So we are using molecular tests for the rapid diagnosis. Then previously the culture will take 6 weeks or 8 weeks. Now liquid cultures are available under RNTCP. Now it is available in Trivandrum in Kerala. Recently it will introduce in Calicut also under RNTCP. So you will get a culture report by 2 weeks. Then now the diagnosis is more easier. Regarding the gastric aspirate, which needs some technical expertise, preferably overnight fasting is needed. Even though it can be done in an ambulatory OP basis patient, but the yield may be less. It is invasive. Whereas induced sputum is less invasive technique. Fasting is not needed. You can do it in an OP basis. It is easily done by a paramedical staff, but which requires personal protection equipments, because the chance to spread the health personally is more in the induced sputum. We will share the videos of the gastric aspirate as well as the induced sputum in our group after this session. I'm not going into details of that because of the time constraints. Okay, Ananda Keshavan.
Yeah, right. It's okay. And so the gold standard is a microbiological demonstration of the bacilli. Either it is by direct observation, direct microscopy examination of the bacilli, as already mentioned by Ashraf, or now we got our own CBNet. So to Bala, please give an overview of the CBNet.
Okay. So CBNet is now the investigation of choice, as you all know. It's a cartridge-based nucleic acid amplification test. This is a summary of the test we do. We have been doing, and now we have to do. That is SMEA for AFB, which is low sensitivity and which is low sensitivity and long time to get the result. The RNTCP approved NAT, which may be a CBNAT, line probe assay, TB lab, TrueNAT. All these have high sensitivity and as well as less time and high specificity also. And the TB culture, liquid culture previously used now, recently as just now sir has said, MGIT, which has improved isolation in a shorter time, whereas solid culture launched into LJ medium, better sensitivity but takes long time. So now the investigation of choice is CBNAT. As Ashu sir said in the beginning, if the three criteria is met, first, what we have to do is the X-ray. You take the child's X-ray, and if it is suggestive of TB, then go for CBNAT. Usually, the current recommendation is CBNAT should be done only if the chest X-ray is suggestive. Otherwise, don't do, because CBNAT in Kerala the sensitivity is only 1%. If you do CBNAT for all children who have more than 2 weeks fever or cough. Whereas, frankly speaking, I have never seen a child with CBNAT positive in my experience. So, if you have the X-ray suggestive, this will increase to 10%. So, what is CBNAT? CBNAT is a sputum is taken in a container like this. Sputum liquefied and inactivated with a 2:1 simple reagent. And then it is transferred, 2 ml of the sputum is transferred to the cartridge. And this cartridge is inserted into the machine. And this is automatically filtered and washed, and after just this is you get the result in 1 hour 45. That is almost within 2 hours you get the printed test result. And almost 1,200 machines have been installed by National Tuberculosis Elimination Program. And this is a highly sensitive test. The threshold limit is 131 CFU per ml, whereas for sputum sphere it is 10,000 CFU. You need to have 10,000 organisms per ml to get positivity. And whereas this is only 131, it is more specific, 99.2% MTB specific, and it's foolproof. No technical expertise is required. It is safe for lab personnel, and it is a closed and open system, no risk of cross contamination, and it gives rifampicin resistant upfront. That is, along with even if there is if MTB is positive, then you'll get the rifampicin resistance result also. And there are some limitations, as I said earlier, the yield will be less if it is lesser than the culture, but if it is yield is more if the X-ray is sensitive, the candidate is ideal, the CBNR result will be more sensitivity will more. In culture positive cases, CBNR positivity is almost 90%. That is why in adults, in almost all adults where the sputum is positive, a smear is positive, CBNR will come 100% positivity, unlike in children. But here, at least it is 90%, and smear is only 30% sensitivity in culture positive cases. In gastric aspirate, it is 68% and 25%. And the initial studies after CBNAT was used upfront in all children having suggestive symptom in India showed the diagnostic yield of 10%. That is in India statistics. In Kerala, what I heard was it is only 1%. So yield improved tremendously up to 30 to 40% when the test focused on asymptomatics with the radiological lesion. Then it becomes 40%. This slide will be elaborated by Ashok sir, but just one, I want to highlight that Expert Ultra, that is the Expert MTB Ultra, there's a still lower detection limit of 16 bacilli compared to 131 for CBNAT, and it is the investigation choice in the future. TrueNAT is another rapid test where you get, it is done in a two-step process. Once the mycobacterium comes negative, you don't have the recombination resistance. That is the advantage of TrueNAT, and depending on the tip, we can do other investigations like even COVID can be done by the TrueNAT, and other communicable disease can be done if you have the chip. And this is the sensitivity of CBNAT, 10% in primary complex, in progressive primary disease is 45 to 50%, and pleural effusion is 30 to 40%. Andreshan sir, thank you.
So that is a very good description about the CBNAT by Dr. Balendran. So we have to keep in mind, it's after X-ray and the demonstration of the bacilli by microscope, and CBNAT is next one. And the culture, we are not routinely going for culture unless there is a suspected drug resistance. The one thing you have to keep in mind is that it is not 100% sure. If TB that is negative, then it doesn't mean there is not tuberculosis. So we have to, again, you have with the support of a clinical background and the X-ray and other support evidence also you have to look for. And my next question is that, again, the CBNAT is 100% sensitive to Dr. Manjusha.
So as we have seen in the previous discussion, CBNAT has evolutionized the diagnosis of TB in children. But still, it's sad that the sensitivity is only about 40 to 45% or to 55% in children, not just 100%. So that is one big caveat that we have in the diagnosis of TB in children. And again, you need a bacilli count of at least 131 per ml to detect. That is why a negative CBNAT cannot rule out a disease. In bacillary disease, you may get a negative CBNAT, but still does not mean that the child is not having TB disease. And again, these figures have already been dealt with in the earlier slides. And when you have a real symptomatic child, you get a more yield on the CBNAT. And if that is clubbed with a positive radiological lesion on your chest X-ray, again, your yield is going to go up to 40%. Again, I would like to stress that a negative CBNAT does not rule out TB. So if you're really thinking of TB, you have to again go into the diagnosis and in examination of the child. So these are the various sensitivities in culture-proven specimens that CBNAT has. As you can see, the maximum sensitivity is for your the tissue specimens, your CSF fluids, and also your gastric aspirates also have a relatively good sensitivity of 78%. But again, for pleural fluids, you have a very low sensitivity of 44%. And other body fluids like pericardial and synovial fluids, the sensitivity is very less. So it is actually very difficult to isolate an organism by doing a CBNAT in such specimens. Also, it should not be a blood contaminated specimen to do a CBNAT.
So here we can see that in CSF and other specimens, it's a very good sensitivity there. But pleural effusion, as rightly mentioned, sensitivity is very poor. Now again, CSF, one problem is that you have to get a very good good volume, around 5 ml, you have to, then only you will get a very good report. So anyway, CPNET is not 100% not rule out to tuberculosis. So what are other newer rapid diagnostic tests to Ashraf? Some briefly, just mention the name.
The Bala and Manjusha already mentioned about all these tests. So I am adding only one word because we are already running late. The Expert Ultra means only 16 bacilli. Bala already needed for the positivity. Whereas Gene Expert, it requires 131 bacilli. So if it is available, Ultra is more useful in pediatric TB. Now in the era of COVID, the same machine, TrueNAT machine and Gene Expert machine is using for the COVID detection also. TrueNAT Expert is foreign technology. TrueNAT is an indigenous technology. The TrueNAT, it is not fully automated, whereas Expert is fully automated. That is the difference. Next slide, Bala. Next slide. Lane probe assay, because RNTCP recommends universal drug resistance testing. So in Gene Expert, we can find whether the bacilli is sensitive to rifampicin or not. Even though rifampicin resistance is a mono resistance, practically we will take it as a multi-drug resistant. Suppose if there is a rifampicin resistant, we have to send the sample for the Lane probe assay to detect additional resistance. That is the need of Lane probe assay. Now it is available in Trivandrum and it will be introduced to Calicut also under the RNTCP soon. Over to another question. That is enough,
so,
I think.
So rightly mentioned, if you are suspecting resistance, first line drugs or second line drugs, you have to go for further test. And what is now the diagnostic algorithm for the diagnosis of tuberculosis, pulmonary tuberculosis? Dr. Bala.
Okay, thanks. So this is a very important question. I think I should take more time for the diagnostic algorithm.
But it should be brief. Our time is...
this is the most important diagnostic to diagnose tuberculosis. And as you all know, the sensitivity will decrease, whereas the specificity will be more as you go up the pyramid. The microbiological diagnosis got more specificity but less sensitivity. And the diagnosis of TB has to be microbiological. A diagnosis should be confirmed as well as it has to be confirmed by microbiological resistance, and it has to be correct by doing the rifampicin resistance. And now the goalposts have moved from MTB detection to MTB and rifampicin resistant detection. So once you diagnose MTB, the rifampicin resistance also has to be detected. So this is the pyramid with the conventional radiology at the main as the first step, and followed by, if it is suggestive, followed by microbiological diagnosis. So for a TB to be diagnosed, it has to be confirmed as well as complete. Completeness means resistance also has to be detected. And once you get a child with a history, suggestive of tuberculosis like persistent fever, cough, and weight loss, first what you have to do is an X-ray test. And if the X-ray test is suggestive of tuberculosis like miliary lymph node or cavity, you do a sputum or a gastric aspiration or an induced sputum, and CBNAT can be done. And if it is positive, there is no confusion, there is microbiologically confirmed tuberculosis. But suppose if it is negative, then look for and test alternate site like enlarged peripheral lymph nodes, or you can do a better quality specimen. You have to refer to a tertiary center to take a BAL if it is a pneumonia or a child is has comorbidity like HIV. Then bronchial lavage has to be done, or a lymph node aspirate has to be done. For that, you have to sometimes you have to refer to a higher center. And suppose if it is positive, then it is microbiologically confirmed. If it is negative, and it has clinically diagnosed for world to. If it is CBNAT positive, then check for rifampin resistance. And if it is detected, resistance detected, you have to treat as drug-resistant tuberculosis. If it is not detected, treat with the first-line drugs. So HIV testing should be offered to all children diagnosed with tuberculosis, and notification is a must. So this is the first step. This X-ray is suggestive of tuberculosis. Now the second scenario is when the child is having same symptoms, but there is the X-ray is non-specific, like bronchopneumonia or pneumonic consolidation, and this is non-specific. These are all non-specific shadows. And then you give a course of appropriate antibody, amoxicillin or amoxiclav for 1 to 2 weeks, and not should not give any other antibody. In pediatric, we don't give much fluoroquinolones or linezolid, so there is no question of that. And once the antibody is completed, repeat the X-ray, and if the shadow is persistent, then go for CBNAT test, and then if it is positive, confirm. If it is negative, then go for higher bronchoalveolar lavage, BAL or lymphonasphalate, and go for NAT again. And the third scenario is when the child presents with all these symptoms and the X-ray is normal. That is what happening very frequently now. And if the X-ray is normal, then go for evaluation of extrapulmonary tuberculosis and refer to higher center for alternate to find out alternate causes. Here, there is no Mando test, unlike as in last year when the X-ray is done along with that, Mando is done. But now there is no role of Mando unless we have this scenario, second scenario, as Anderson sir said in the, Ashraf sir has said in the beginning, if the clinically diagnosed probable TB, we can do a Mando test to rule out extrapulmonary tuberculosis. So to sum up, diagnosis means chest X-ray first. If it is suggestive, sputum, gastric acid or induced sputum, you can go for CBNAT. If it is positive, microbiologically confirmed TB. If it is then confirmed with the rifampicin, which is you get it CBNAT, the resistance to rifampicin. If it is negative, the CBNAT is negative, go for higher, better quality specimen and refer to higher center PL or lymph node aspirate. If it is positive, it is microbiologically confirmed. If it is negative, then it is clinically diagnosed probable tuberculosis case. And the chest X-ray, non-specific shadows, again, a course of antibiotic, 1 or 2 weeks, no shadows persisting, go for CBNAT. If it is positive, it is microbiologically confirmed. It is negative, then it is clinically diagnosed probable case. And lastly, the CBNAT is, chest X-ray is normal, for extra to evaluate for extra pulmonary tuberculosis. And always do HIV testing for all children diagnosed with the tuberculosis and notification they must.
So, very nicely described, Dr. Bala. So, you may get a X-ray suggestive, you may get a non-specific X-ray, you may get a normal X-ray. If it is normal X-ray, already mentioned, it may be extrapulmonary tuberculosis. If it is highly suggestive, then with the help of a microbiological test, you can confirm. And if it is non-specific shadow, as I already mentioned, like a pneumonia, you can give a course of antibiotic not affecting the mycobacterium, then you can go for, you can, if this shadow is persistent, then you can go for clinically diagnosed TB. Okay, next, next one, Bada.
Yeah,
so what is the basis of TB treatment? Because I think there's not much change in the two phases, intensive phase and the conditioning phase. And the driver of the drug is something different. So, what is importance of IP and CP and what is the difference also? Over to Manjusha.
So, the first slide, I'll be dealing with the basis of chemotherapy. Why do you have a combination of drugs in your the package of anti-tubercular therapy? First, we have to understand there are three types of organisms of bacilli that I see. One is the actively dividing organisms, which are mainly seen in the pulmonary focus, your cavities, which you know have a rapid mitotic rate, and these are the most susceptible organisms to your anti-tubercular therapy. And that is where your INH, your streptomycin, your rifampicin and all acts. Then you have the intracellular slowly multiplying organisms. These are the villains that we have because these remain dormant or these remain latent in inside the cell where it's very difficult for this ATT to reach. And there is where your pyrazinamide has a big role. And then you have some a very small amount of extracellular slowly multiplying organisms who remain dormant for most of the time, except for some spurts of metabolism where actually they can go on to cause a disease or they can cause just a dormant infection as such. And INH and rifampicin are to deal with such types of organisms. So next slide, please. So the number of bacilli also vary with the number of the type of lesion, the maximum seen in a cavity. and the drug resistance, the maximum drug resistance is to rifampicin. That is why you have to do a universal drug sensitivity test to rifampicin and then followed by INH. Next slide, please, sir. Now, as we know, we have two phases of intensive of TB treatment, the intensive phase and the continuation phase. So I'm not going to the details of this. As we know, the intensive phase is hitting hard. You are hitting hard on the bacilli and causing the death of a majority of bacilli in the first 2 months of your treatment. So, and addition of pyrenizamides to deal with the intracellular bacilli has reduced the TB treatment from a minimum years to then to just 6 months. And the continuation phase is to deal with the other, you know, slowly multiplying extracellular bacilli and the few intracellular bacilli which is left after the intensive phase. And a few number of drugs are needed here. So you have to have the DOTS, directly observed treatment short course, with the right dose, the right, next slide please, sir. The right drugs, the right doses, right fixed drug combinations that we'll be dealing with in our coming slides, and you should complete the course. And there should be good adherence to the treatment, and you should see that the child has been cured. Next slide.
So again, so usually you have to give 6 months treatment, 2 months intensive, and 4 months continuation, even though there's some changes there for EBM. We'll discuss that point later. But before that, so what is new in 2020 about IEP and TEP guidelines?
There are a lot of new welcome changes in 2020 recommendation when compared to 2014. There is an addition of ethambutol in the continuation phase, that is 3 drug, which is already mentioned. This is to combat high prevalence of INH monoresistance. Thanks to RNTCP, now it is daily treatment. In 2014, it was biweekly treatment. There is no business of extension of intensive phase in case of poor response. Instead, test for the resistance. And if it is a drug-resistant tuberculosis, treat accordingly. There is no separate category now, only one category. The category 1, category 2 has removed, now only one category. Then rifampicin resistance is managed as a multi-drug resistance TB. Retreatment cases, that means after stopping the treatment, again the child is symptomatic. The retreatment category also changed. In that case, we have to test the drug resistance and treat accordingly. If it is a drug responsive bacilli, there is no drug resistance, the same regime. We will repeat the same regime. If the drug resistance is detected, we will treat it as a drug resistant strain. Then, next slide, Bala. There is a practical problem. If a child lost follow-up or there is an interruption of the treatment, if the days of interruption is less than 4 weeks, you can continue the same regime. It is not 30 days, it is 4 weeks, 28 days. If it is 4 weeks or more, test for drug sensitivity and treat accordingly. So if a child is lost to follow up, if he is coming again within 4 weeks, you continue the same treatment with an extension of days he lost space. That if he is lost to 15 days, final extension for the 15 days. If it is in the intensive phase, extension in the intensive phase. If it is continuation phase, the extension is in the continuation phase. Then next slide, Bala. This is the single guideline, all category 2, INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol, initial 2 months. Then continuation phase, 3 drugs, 4 months. For the neurotuberculosis, as well as the tuberculosis meningitis or nervous system, CNS tuberculosis, the continuation phase is 10 months. That means 2 months initial phase for drugs, then 3 drugs for the 10 months. That is total of 12 months. Only one category. You forget all other categories. Now only one category. It is very simple. Over to moderator, Dr. Anandakeshavan.
So it's a very good discussion of the treatment. The thing is that that is very simplified, over simplified, because previously when we had it was three category, later it is two category, now it is only one category is there, and except TBM treatment is same, it is 6 months only. And now we have to, I think we have to go for it quickly because time is. So what about the lymph node treatment, the general guidelines by Dr. Bala? Dr. Bala?
Bala?
Dr. Bala?
Dr. Bala, your turn.
Bala?
Bala, next slide.
Next slide.
Ranjit, what happened?
Bala sir, unmuted ana. Pakshe sir, kekunnilla avo.
On the phone level.
So lymph node, the most common site. Okay, the most common age group is 5 to 9.
It is audible. Now it is audible. Unmute. Unmute, Bala. You unmute.
Unmute.
Bala, unmute in your device.
Okay, ipo kekkam.
Kelkam.
Kelkam.
Hello, kekkam.
Welcome.
Okay. So, among lymph node cervical is the most common site, and 5 to 9 years age group is commonest age group affected. The systemic symptoms occurs in 50% of the cases, and more than 70% TST will be positive. And with the treatment, there will be decrease in size of the lymph node, even though it will not subside completely. And as the fine needle aspirate shows, if you do CB9 diagnosis for diagnosis, it will be 88.3% positivity. And coming to the most important slide, that is the diagnosis of lymph node tuberculosis. Once you get a lymph node of more than minimum 2 centimeters dimension should be there. Small size below 2 centimeters, there is no need to think of tuberculosis. And this should be, if the lymph node is matted or if it is the cold abscess or if there is sinus forming, then you directly do a FNAC or CBNAT or FB smear or pus from lymph node can be taken for CBNAT. And if the yield is, if it is a smear, it is only 10 to 15%, but culture yields 20 to 50% positivity and CBNAT yields 35% positivity. And if FB is detected on smear, it is suggestive of tuberculosis lymphadenopathy or CBNAT positive, or in FNAC there is caseous granuloma, or you start ATT. And if there is no granuloma, or if there is non-caseous granuloma in the FNAC or no FB or smear, you do an excision biopsy and go for excision biopsy. If the size is the lymph node is not tender and firm, if it is not matted, discrete lymph nodes, then give a 7-day course of antibiotic and review after 2 weeks. And if there is no response, if there is no difference in size of the lymph node, go for again FNAC or CBNAT, fine needle aspiration cytology. And if it is negative, go for excision biopsy. So that is the algorithm of lymph node, tuberculous lymphadenopathy.
So again, lymph node enlargement is very common problem in children. So Bala, over.
Yeah, over.
So again, tuberculosis lymph node enlargement is very common problem. So many times we used to treat over-treat lymph node tuberculosis also. So either you have to do FNAC, or if not possible biopsy. Then if there's doubt, in separate case, you can give a course of antibiotic also. Now we'll go briefly through TB and treatment, tuberculosis meningitis treatment, general guidelines briefly, and also with some question about Sherol also. Over to Manju.
I'll be just rushing through the slides because I'm not going to explain the stages. As you know, there are 3 stages of TBM and with a whole lot of complications. So can we go to the next slide? So hydrocephalus, tuberculoma formations are all complications. So the basis of treatment is that you have to eradicate the bacilli that has entered the CNS. So these should be CNS penetrating drugs. So ATT, as sir mentioned in the previous slides, is given for a total of 12 months with 2 months of intensive phase and 10 months of continuation phase to cause complete eradication of the bacilli. Then you have to give steroids to bring down the inflammation. We'll be dealing that in the next slide. Decongestive therapy should be used in cases where there is raised ICP, which is commonly seen in the second stage of TBM. Anti-epileptics, if the child is symptomatic, having seizures, even in tuberculoma, the child may throw a seizure. And surgical intervention, if raised ICP is not controlled by your medical measures, you have to go for a drainage, especially if there is a sequelae like hydrocephalus, you may have to do a ventricular drain or an EVD, you'll have to put an EVD or a shunt. And even in stage 2 and 3, a shunt can help a lot in improving the quality of life of a child with tuberculous meningitis. So coming to the steroid proper, sir, next slide please. Sir. So these are just why it is the advantage of steroids, always reducing inflammation, reducing your CSF protein and globulin, and preventing the infarction vasculitis, which is all the pathophysiology or etiopathogenesis of TBM. And the problem is it again brings down your immunity, it causes GI bleeding and decreases the penetration of antituberculous drug, which is again a big problem. Next slide, sir. So steroids. You can give any steroid in equipotent dose. Usually we use prednisolone in 1 to 2 milligrams per kilogram per day with a maximum of, with a ceiling of 60 mg per day. Or you can use dexamethasone in the dose of 0.6 mg per kg per day. So you can use any steroid in equipotent dose. You have to give it for 4 weeks and then taper over the next 4 weeks and stop. And it should be used in any severity of the disease, because even in stage 1 and 2, if you're diagnosing, you should start with steroids to prevent the complications that can occur in TB. Sir.
So the TB treatment mainly include medical treatment and surgical treatment. And the medical treatment already mentioned drug proper, steroid, anti-epileptic drug, decongestive measures, and also most important is nutritional aspects also we have to concentrate. And now it is not very, you cannot start tuberculosis treatment like just like that, putting a 2HR, 4HA like that. So you have to describe each and every point, what is important, everything. So writing a TB description is something different. So I think Dr. Ashraf can mention about the how, what are things you have to write during a prescription.
Okay, Bala. Any prescription is a medico-legal document, which is more important in the TB prescription. You have to write the diagnosis, tuberculosis. Cox is not acceptable. So details is needed. That means if it is a pulmonary tuberculosis or an extrapulmonary tuberculosis, and the basis of the diagnosis, whether it's a microbiologically confirmed case, CBNAT positive, or it is a clinically diagnosed TB. Then type of the patient, that means whether there is a resistance detected or not, whether the drug resistance is there or not. Then past history of treatment, that means is it a first case or a retreatment case? Then type of the disease, treatment plan, that means type of disease, whether it is pulmonary, whether it is extrapulmonary, whether it is TB meningitis. Treatment plan, that means 2-4 drugs plus 4 months, 3 drugs. That clearly, you have to mention it clearly. 2 months, INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide and ethambutol. 4 months, INH, rifampicin and ethambutol. Then we have to, that is a legal obligation, we have to notify the case to the authority, RNDCP. So you write in the prescription, the case is notified to the RNDCP cell. And we have to arrange, the RNDCP people will arrange the treatment support. There are a lot of support, including the drugs, investigation, financial support also. The Bala will come to that in the last slide. Okay. Okay.
So it is the duty of each and every person to give proper instruction, proper prescription writing, and also, as Ashraf rightly mentioned, notification also very, very important. Now, next question is to summarize about adjunct therapy. There are steroid already mentioned. What are other adjunct therapy in tuberculosis?
Okay, so there are 3 adjunctive therapies: steroids, vitamin B6, and surgery. The steroids indications are all this given here, CNS tuberculosis, TB spine, medullary tuberculosis, pericarditis, sudden involvement, intracranial tuberculosis, vasculitis, TB uveitis, and iris. And it can be given for all these conditions. So every pleural effusion not give unless it is compromising the respiratory system. Or intestinal tuberculosis, if there is stricture, you can give. If there is massive ascites, if there is tuberculous lymph node which compresses the vital structures. All these are indications for starting steroids, not for all cases. And all tuberculous meningitis cases has to be treated with steroids. Pleural tuberculosis, when the mass when it is massive and bilateral, and in pericarditis, steroids will, tuberculous pericarditis will decrease the mortality and prevent constriction and prevent reaccumulation of the fluids. Vitamin B6, everybody knows about B6. It was given previously only during the holiday period, but now it has been recommended the INH for daily treatment, because INH dose has been increased to 10 to 15 milligram, and that will increase the dose-related adverse effects. And there is high prevalence of malnutrition in children. And the third reason for starting B6 is the it is in young children, it is difficult to diagnose peripheral neuropathy. And lastly, in the past, every child on continuation phase was getting pyridoxine only on drug holidays. But now the current recommendation is routine pyridoxine supplementation, all children receiving ATT or INH prophylactic therapy, even though we are not giving B6 along with INH prophylactic therapy. The dose is 10 milligram daily, and it can increase to 50 to 100 depending on the cause. If it is a drug-resistant case, when cyclosporine is given, we have to give up to 100 milligram. And if there is B6 deficiency, you need to give only up to 50 milligram daily. So the recommendation is 10 milligram daily along with the ATT. And the, lastly, the surgery indications, when there is when want the removal of retained cecum, occasions from discharging sinuses, decompression of spinal canal, PP shunt for hydrocephalus, pericardectomy, or lobar resection as in bronchiectasis, and you have to remove the lobe. All these are surgeries which will come under as adjunctive therapy in the management of tuberculosis. Okay.
So, Shiroad already mentioned the different indication and also treatment duration, TBM. Pyridoxine, you have to give all cases, because here, new according to new regime, we not mentioned the exact dose, but the drug dosage is little bit high when compared to other INH and the reformation and the pyridoxine doses. I think increase, so there is a definite indication for pyridoxine. Surgical already mentioned. And once we started the treatment, how will you monitor the treatment, TB treatment? Over to Manjusha.
So monitoring, you should know when to monitor, what to monitor, and how do you monitor. So when to monitor, the first visit, you should call back the child after 2 weeks to see if the child has actually got all his medicines, if it's a correct fixed drug combination he has got, and whether he's taking it, and to see if there is any adverse effects that he's having from taking the drug. And then after that, you should see him every month to again recheck how he's doing on the medicines, what is his adherence, to counsel the child and the parents about the need for adherence and completion of therapy, and to look for the adverse effects. And so next, what to assess? First, you have to assess if you have given, again, you know, every time ask yourself, have you given the correct drug? Have you given the correct FDC? Has his weight increased? Should you change the FDC to another one? Second, you have to see if the child is improving, if the symptoms are coming down, if it's a responsive, drug responsive type of disease. And the third thing, you have to see if this child is developing any adverse effects because of the drug. And clinically, you look for weight gain, which may be seen only in 75% of children. And you look for the subsidence of symptoms that the child had. And then microbiologically, you have to do confirmation by a sputum or a gastric aspirate at the end of intensive phase. And also at the end of treatment, to confirm that the child has been cured of TB. And follow-up x-rays should only be done if the child is failing to improve, the child has new symptoms, and need not be done just to see if the lesion has gone or not. And children with HIV, children with severe acute malnutrition, anti-convulsive therapy, neuro-TB should be under special follow-up. And also look, if you have seen children who just bring back the blister telling that they have taken everything, but the drugs are all in the garbage. So you'll have to look for the pill count. You have to give social and maybe financial support for the family. A and also counsel them at each visit. So, and the clinical response, usually you see a defervescence by the end of 2 to 4 weeks, but it may take longer, even up to two months. Weight gain, that is only seen in 75%. Some children don't gain weight at all. And any deviation in this, if the child is worsening on your treatment, the symptoms are not improving, you have to think of drug-resistant TB if you have made your diagnosis of TB right. Yes, sir.
So proper monitoring is very important, and you won't get the immediate release of cough. It will take 2 to 4 weeks. And again, to gain the weight also, it will take another 2 to 4 weeks. So that you have to keep in mind. And also, once in a while, the child may deteriorate, even though child is responding to a drug. So in such a situation, you have to think about paradoxical response. So Ashraf, what is a paradoxical response to AKT?
Andreshu, sir, we have to stop by 10 o'clock. We have to stop by 10 o'clock.
This is my last question.
Next slide. Last question. Whenever a child on ATT is not responding or worsening symptoms or signs, ask this question. Is the patient is taking pills, correct regime, correct dose? That is treatment adherence. If this is true TB, especially in a clinically diagnosed TB, recheck whether any other cause for the persistent pneumonia. Then whether it's a drug sensitive TB. In a drug resistant TB also, child will not respond to treatment. If all these things are excluded, consider the possibility of iris or paradoxical response. That means, iris means immune reconstitution, inflammatory response. Next slide, Bala, next slide. So it is an exclusion diagnosis. It is an exclusion diagnosis. Exclude the comorbidities, non-adherence, medication error, and drug resistance. Next slide, Bala. So paradoxical response means enlargement of old lesion or unexpected appearance of new lesions during apparently adequate ATT. Usually occurs in the initial weeks of the treatment, but it can occur later, even late as 2 years, especially in the lymph node tuberculosis, but commonly around 6 to 8 weeks. So these are the various manifestations of the paradoxical response. You just go through that slide. Over to moderator.
So we go to some more questions, and 3-4 questions are remaining, but we start a little late. And now abnormal LFT, and about if mother is affected, what will do with neonate. So many some questions, important practical questions are there, but due to lack of time,
we will share the slide.
So you can rush through slide, Bala.
Yeah. We will rush through.
Rush through the slide. Okay.
Yeah.
So in abnormal LFT, only that algorithm is needed, Bala.
Yeah. So these are the effects of all drugs, and I will show the definition of DILI, that is drug-induced liver injury. You can say the liver is injured when there is rise in SGOT, SGPT more than 5 times, even with no symptoms, or more than 3 times with symptoms like nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea, or if there is rise in level of serum total bilirubin above 1.5, then only you can say that there is drug-induced liver injury. And we'll go to the algorithm proper. When there is a symptom suggesting like nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, or unexplained fatigue, you do the SGPT. If it is more than 5 times the normal or 3 times the normal with symptoms, or if there is jaundice, stop ATT. If the patient is very sick, like tuberculosis meningitis, you can start other drugs like levofloxacin, streptomycin, and amitriptyline, and stopping all other INH, rifampicin, and pyrazinamide. Repeat the ALT after 7 days. And if the ALT is less than 2 times upper limit of normal, then start rifampicin in full dose, not partially. It can start being started in full dose. If they again repeat LFT after 3 days, if the ALT is less than 2 times the normal, then add INH. First rifampicin, next is INH in full dose. They again repeat LFT in another 3 to 7 days. If the ALT is less than 2 times the normal, add pyrazinamide in full dose. And whenever, if there is resurgence of ALT more than 5 times or recurrence of jaundice, omit the offending drug. And if it is there, when you start rifampicin, you have to stop rifampicin and modify the regime accordingly. So, and restart the therapy when feasible. For deciding the final duration of therapy, do not take into account the number of days the full complement of original treatment was missed and complete the full treatment. There is interruption in first 4 weeks and then restart the regimen.
Okay. Yes. So, Dr. Sen, with the permission of Manjusha, I am just describing three conditions. One is that if child is not improving, second one is the contact with the regression TB, third one is some immunosuppression or malnutrition. These things, under this circumstance, you are thinking about regressions. Regressions case, we are not supposed to manage. So, special drugs are there. We have to refer to RDCP. We have to refer, which is not our control. And we have to do culture test. So I think with this, we'll pass that question, Manjusha, with your permission. Next question. Yes, sir. Next question. Bala?
Yeah.
So it is another important question. Even though it is an interesting question, we are not seeing that much of problem. But for academic, for PE students also, it is important. So what about the perinatal tuberculosis? Because it may not be neonatal, but it is a perinatal tuberculosis. So a brief outline. Ashraf.
There are three ways of spread. It is a transplacental spread, then the primary focus will be the liver. Aspiration or ingestion of the amniotic fluid through the during the delivery, then primary focus will be in the GIT. Or it may be a contact infection from the mother or a hospital worker or from a family member. Then primary focus will be the lung. Next slide. So the management is, if baby is symptomatic, palpate for liver, take a chest X-ray. If the mother is on treatment for tuberculosis. If the baby is symptomatic, evaluate the baby and then treat as per the guideline. That is 2+4. 4 drugs for 2 months, 3 drugs for 4 months. If the baby is asymptomatic, no active disease, INH prophylaxis for 6 months. No INH prophylaxis for drug-resistant TB. No prophylaxis for drug-resistant TB. If the mother is having drug-resistant TB. While on INH prophylaxis, follow up the child and look for and evaluate for TB disease. Because if the baby is, even though baby is on INH prophylaxis, he may develop symptom during the prophylaxis. Give breast milk, give BCG. Isolation is required and EBM may be given in case of drug-resistant TB in the mother or if the mother is not adhering to the treatment. Okay. Okay, too.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Next slide.
So, in all cases, you have to give BCG, you have to give INH prophylaxis, and regression cases, you have to take you have to continue breastfeeding, and regression cases, you have to get the aspirate
opinion. EBM.
And so, what about Bala, the management of BCG adenitis?
So, BCG adenitis is it's a very common condition. There is a preceding history of vaccination on the same side can appear anytime within the first year. It is appears when it given subcutaneous and injection given high up on the shoulder. All these can produce tuberculosis BCG lymphadenitis and never has associated systemic issues in healthy children. So it can be simple BCG adenitis when there is it will regress spontaneously over a period of 6 to 8 months, even up to 1 year, can progress to abscess, or it can
stop. Ranjit, any problem?
Network in the issue again, sir. Network slow item.
Time
now. Network is slow item now. Sir, and out
there. I think we finished almost all questions except. Two questions. One is latent TB, that is also important. I agree. Second one is the involvement of the private practitioners. I think that we also discussed. We have to definitely report according to the Nishchay program and everything. We have to report all tuberculosis cases, and there is a special mobile application is there. Some reward for reporting doctors, patients, tribal patients, special. There are some things are there. Anyway. Due to lack of time, and previously we had 205 members, now only 103, still it is there. And we will take some questions. I think majority of questions, the audience ask questions in advance. So I think we covered almost all questions. There's one or two questions that I think we can take. Ashraf?
There is a question. How will you diagnose leg resistance? I will answer. Ananda Keshava, I will answer that question. How will you diagnose leg resistance? In CBNAT, you will know whether the strain is rifampicin sensitive or resistant. That is the first test you have to do. If the rifampicin resistance is there, you send another sample for a line probe assay to detect other resistance. So the first we will check whether the strain is rifampicin resistant. That is, you will get that result by sending the CBNAT. CBNAT detects the mycobacteria as well as the rifampicin resistance.
Yeah. One question is that about Mandor strength. It is very commonly asked for Mandor strength, 2TU or 5TU?
It is 2TU.
2TU only. There is no question of 5TU. And BCG is, BCG score is not there. Any role for repeat BCG, Ashraf?
There is no such recommendation in the current guideline.
What is the role of bronchoalveolar lavage when you do it? Ashraf, you can also.
In an expert center, in a persistent pneumonia, you may go for a bronchoalveolar lavage. The expert means that should be it is not an expert person only, expert facility. You have to do all the investigation for the persistent pneumonia. The facility should be there.
What about the role of MGAT? Last question, MGAT.
MGAT means?
Mycobacterium growth inhibition test, MGAT. MGAT.
That is the culture test, MGAT.
Yeah.
That is liquid culture. Previously, the conventional culture takes 6 to 8 weeks for the results. Now, the liquid culture is available at Trivandrum regional lab. You will get the result within 2 weeks. That is the advantage.
So, I think we covered other questions during our talk itself.
Any questions I answered by chat during
the session. Yeah. They asked questions in advance. CK session, sir, he's still there.
CK sir.
Yeah. And Dr. Reddy, can you unmute? Reddy, to propose the water thanks. Reddy?
Yes.
Please unmute and just propose the water thanks. Anyway, I thank my panel members, Dr. Ashraf, for a wonderful session, and also Dr. Balayendran, and also Dr. Enthusiastic Dr. Manjush also. For official water thanks, our President, Dr. Dadi Sandhavumar.
Thank you, Ananda Keshavan, for this opportunity, as well as the Bala and Dr. Narayana.
Greetings.
I'm happy to see the Manjusha also in the panel.
Thank you, sir. It's a great honor to be with my teachers on this panel.
What to Dadi?
Am I audible?
Yeah,
you are audible.
So greetings to all on behalf of Thrissur IAP. It is very good that we have deviated from the corona, focusing on corona and now focusing on a very important killer, silent killer, AFP. So at the primary, I would like to thank President Dr. Narayanan, who has incorporated TB-free air and knowledge of TB to all practitioners who are treating children. Thank you, sir. Thanks to our dynamic state secretary, Dr. Balachandar, who was on the list today. It was indeed a privilege that our KGMOA secretary, Dr. Vijay Krishnan, has inaugurated the session. The panelists, Dr. Ashraf, who's the additional professor at Kozhikode, Dr. Balachandar, and Manjusha have really given us an informative session on how to treat TB in children. A big thanks to all of you. Dr. Ananda Keshavan, you are a mentor guiding us to decide on which session we should take. Thank you, and please continue the good work. Thank you to each and every one of you all, IAP Kozhikode also, for helping us. And a meeting is never complete if there are delegates. I can see senior delegates like Shashindran sir and many others. Thanks to each and everyone, and good night.
Yeah, I would like to thank Dr. Anjit and the IAP Kozhikode team, and especially to our Narayan and Bala also for giving this opportunity. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank
good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Ranjit.